Hi, everyone. How's it going? I'm super excited to be here with all of you. As mentioned, my name is Amanda Parris. I'm the host of a television show called Exhibitionists on CBC, a radio, an R&B music radio show called Marvin's Room on CBC Radio, and I write a weekly column for CBC Arts. Outside of that, I do a bunch of fun things, but I'm going to pass it on to you guys to introduce yourselves.
Hi, I am Charles Officer. I make films, documentaries, fiction, and work in television as well. And I'm really, really honored to be here. And I love being around young energy who are also trying to find their way, and anything we can provide through this conversation to help you, inspire you, encourage you, empower you. That's, I hope that we do that.
Hello, everyone. My name is Desmond, and I'm a journalist and an activist in the city. I have just been working on a film with Charles called The Skin We're In, a documentary that's going to premiere on March 9th on CBC.
So throughout the film, you travel to numerous locations. And I was recently speaking with an elder who talked about the spiritual link that African descendant folks have across geographical locations. I wanted to know a little bit about what the experience was for you, Desmond, meeting all of these people and gathering all of these stories, because that position of the gatherer of stories is a really important one, but it's also a heavy one.
It's also personal in many ways because, for example, so being in Nova Scotia for me is like, my parents are both born in Freetown, Sierra Leone. So what that means for us is that we have a connection in part to this land, to Nova Scotia, because my ancestors, specifically the group of people that my parents descended from, are freed, enslaved Black people from the Caribbean, England, and Nova Scotia.
Did you know this before making this film?
I knew it before making this film, but I didn't know it growing up as a young person in Canada. I didn't know what a direct link my ancestry has to this land. Nobody told me. So it's very powerful being there and thinking about that. I don't know exactly where my line comes from. I don't know if my personal ancestors were on this land before. It's very possible, though. And so that's like a really deep and profound, heavy thing in and of itself.
You're there as human beings, you're there as Black folks who are in the midst of all of this, but you're also there with very specific purpose, work purpose. How do you balance those things? How do you move through it? How do you continue to keep filming? How do you continue to keep interviewing? Like, what was that experience like? And I know it's ongoing because neither of you are just doing this on a project basis. It's a life of work. But what does that look like? And I know that that answer may change from day to day. It's not a one size fits all. But in this particular instance, working on this film, dealing and balancing the emotional impact of gathering these stories, how did you move through it?
There isn't a lot of separation for me. I guess in some ways that could be considered to be unhealthy sometimes. Could be considered even to be unprofessional by some people. But I can't really put any distance between myself and the work that I'm doing. How many people in this room, for example, saw the video of a Black man at about Dundas and Church Streets a couple of weeks ago being assaulted by the police while his hands were cuffed behind his back? How many of you saw that video or heard about that story in this room? Put your hand up. A lot of you. I don't have to go to St. Louis to find that story. That's why it hurts, because I know that that's happening here all the time, and we are similarly, as a society, in denial that that happens all the time, and that it happens to us because we're Black. So it's impossible for me to separate that out. that's the work, and it's deeply personal.
And Charles, you mentioned that just as we were talking earlier, that that was something that you really wanted to illustrate in the film, that in the midst of this, in the midst of all of this violence, all of this trauma, and this consistent history of being brutalized and being dehumanized, that people still have this incredible hope and love. Why do you, and that this is something that a lot of folks don't know about. What about that is... like, why is that integral for you to include in this film?
I think it was integral just really because it's part of our healing process, you know? And I think that, because it does blow my mind at times, because, you know, we've experienced certain things and you get angry and you have these feelings that come up in you. And we need people to, as examples, or to teach us that, you know, how to gauge our anger or those emotions that come up in us that make us want to react in a certain way. And, you know, when we're looking at generationally, we're seeing hearing a man in Canada who's wearing his Jimi Hendrix shirt and he looks a little ragged and stuff. And he stood for something for a period of time and understands the injustice that actually happened, but he still... holding on to this place of like, I'm here to talk, like I'm ready to come to the table if you're ready to hold yourself accountable. And I think that's constantly the sort of issues that, you know, the thoughts that go through your head is like, if I'm willing to come to the table after being abused, I think that is such where we have to understand that it's, I was reading the quote or something like that, like, was it an eye for an eye and then no one can see or something like that?
Yeah, the whole world goes blind.
And then the whole world goes blind, right? So there has to be a space, and what breaks my heart is that it's constantly the people who are oppressed who are more open to find solutions in a way or have to seek love and it's as a way to heal for themselves. And I think it's important that they're saying it, and I think it's what they're saying for themselves. But that message is very important because, you know, two hateful parties is just going to constantly create hateful parties.
Something that's really important to understand about this struggle is that what's constantly happening is we are being told as Black people that we're the cause of the violence, that we're the cause of the suffering, that we're the cause of the fear. Black Lives Matter protests, and we don't talk about what were they protesting. We talk about, oh, but they did it in the middle of the parade and they made the people angry. Oh, they went to the police station and they shut it down and they blocked the road. You're taking our lives. You're literally taking our lives, and you want us to protest in a way that makes you comfortable? We refuse. On principle, we refuse to make you feel comfortable about killing us. What kind of people would we be? And so the great irony is that Black people show all of the restraint and courage and resilience in the world, but are yet still constantly told we're not saying it right. We're not doing it right. And this, there's this mythology that if we were just nice enough, if we just ask in the right way, then you're going to give it to us. That's BS. We're not going to be given this. We have to take it. Because if we were going to wait, we would be waiting forever. Our people have never asked for something unreasonable. We've just asked to be treated fairly. And when we don't get treated fairly, we're not going to sit back and wait for the system that's doing it to us. We're going to go out and take what we need because that's the moral and fair thing to do.
I'm wondering, in making this particular documentary, were you thinking about an ideal audience? And who is that ideal audience? And what impact do you hope that this particular documentary, which I think is also another example of reshaping the narrative of Canada, what impact do you hope it'll have?
While making this project, I can just say there's been a lot of conversation about audience and who this piece can speak to and who would be uncomfortable taking it in. And when I think of audience, I think of my family. I think of and my family's extended, and I mean to the point where we're always having this conversation about, you know, why make something and preach to the choir? How do we reach these other people and convince them? Number one, it's a film that's 44 minutes. Bob Marley says something, you know, you can lead them to the water, you can't make them drink. I think there's, none of this stuff is new. I think there's a lot of stuff that's been out there for people to either take in, choose to listen, to have this sort of space of wanting to understand and actually participate because you are here. But even Desmond and I talk about this, that, you know, the choir needs to be looked after too. They need to be, you know, really, really supported. And they need to know that they are being fueled with energy to keep singing. And they can't be forgotten. It's not like there's just like people are convinced and you leave them alone. People change their minds, you know. We change our minds. And so I really feel like this audience, this piece is for anyone who really wants to absorb it, who wants to actually at least listen, not, you know, it's like, well, I've been through this too. It's like to actually listen to somebody when they tell you about an experience. It's not about, you know, comparable suffering and who can outdo each other. So I really feel like I want the young folks, all you folks that are in here who've ever been, who was actually interested in even coming to listen to us speak today, you're the audience I want to reach, the ones who actually come out. And perhaps you'll touch somebody and take a little something here and you'll pass something on and pass something on. So I really, really believe that that the choir needs to be supported and they need to be reminded of the things that what we're out here doing.
If I can just quickly add to that too, I think it's important for us to remind ourselves as Black people and of the true allies and solidarity with Black people. And I'm talking about not the people who talk about being with us, but who actually show up for us. That group of people is enough. We are enough. We are enough to make the real changes that need to be made in this world. The idea that what we do to make change is that we participate in a democratic process that hates us, that has let us get into this position in the first place, and that we convince 50% plus one of people that our lives actually are worth saving and protecting and valuing. That has never happened in human history. That has never, you guys hear what I'm saying? That has never, ever happened. There has never been a time where Black people convinced the majority who were benefiting from their oppression to be nice. It's never happened. We have to take shit. We have to insist because it won't be given unless we do. And so we are enough. We don't have to spend our lives trying to convert people who waste our time, who want to doubt everything we say, who want more evidence. Sometimes we have to leave those people to ourselves. And as Charles said, we have to take care of our own because we already know. So we can spend our time loving and supporting one another, or we could spend our time arguing with people who are not going to listen to us anyway. Which would we rather do? I think it should be obvious.
Earlier on, Charles mentioned that you see Desmond as like our James Baldwin. And
I don't mean to put that pressure on, but I just do. We all have our visions, but yes. When I first heard about Desmond Cole and started to read him before, you know, this really article exploded and just get to know this, is we do hear about people within the community and what they're doing, we check in on them. I immediately had this moment where I was like, huh, I'm looking at my equivalent of a little James Baldwin. And I was like, I haven't had in my experience, like, you know, someone who was of a certain generation, speaking a certain way, articulating things in a certain way. And I felt like, wow, this is a dope individual that I really respect. And then when the story came out in Toronto Life and all the hoopla around it, I basically, you know, really was moved by it and respected that it was out there. And this is a bit of an issue. It's like we're constantly in this place where it does break my heart that generationally as I'm getting older that I see young folk like here and thinking about what you're going to have to freaking fight through. It's just natural. It's unless, you know, things kind of shift in a way. But you know, it's just to hear this again, another from the American side of like talking about these things. And I just really think it, when you take it in, it's just these things, how do they apply to right now and you and where you are and what you see around you? And I always feel like it's important that, you know, it's, you have to do the work. You have to actually go and get a book. You actually have to show up at something. You have to seek in people whose voices you dig and going to the lecture or whatever, and doing your homework. And I think when I'm chilling around at home sometimes, I need to pop on, you know, James Baldwin and watch a couple of clips just to get inspired or just learn something new. And it's as simple as that. And I think we do that.
So Desmond, I know you said before, like, even with doing like the family reunion or anything, like you said that no one taught you about your history or anything. So what kind of put you guys, like, I guess what pushed you to learn about your history and to get into the work that you were doing?
I think it just got more interesting as I got older. I just think I became more curious, because the older I got, the more I realized that I had never learned and had never been taught to me, but the things that I did know were really interesting and were personal. Why is it that we talk so much about school curriculums and what we get taught at school? It's because when what you get taught at school feels like it's about you, it's way more interesting. It's way more relevant. So when we talk about, for example, I did a lot of history in my schooling about the Second World War. But we specifically talked in the Second World War about Nazi Germany and about the decision by the British and the Americans and Canada to wage war. And lots of the people in my classrooms, that's their grandparents who are being talked about there. Their grandparents were the ones who were involved in that conflict. My family was not. That doesn't mean we weren't doing anything in the 1940s. That doesn't mean we didn't exist. But our history was never talked about. And our history, even that related so directly to Canada, was never shared with me. But as I got older and I started learning about stuff, I was like, wow, that's really actually quite interesting. I wish I knew more. I wish I had been told that before. And I think the other thing that happened was the more that I started to focus on things like policing, the more I learned that, well, this is nothing new. People have been having these conversations in Toronto for decades. I didn't grow up in Toronto, by the way. I grew up in Oshawa, Ontario. And I was born in Red Deer, Alberta. But I guess, like, as I got older and as I started getting into these issues, I learned how people in the 80s were doing what Black Lives Matter Toronto is doing today. Protesting against Black people being killed by the police, by going out into the streets and by really disrupting and saying what you're doing is not good enough. It's not going to work anymore. So when you learn that you're not the only one, when you learn that you're part of a tradition of people who have been doing the same thing, it makes the work feel a lot more grounded, I guess I could say.
You guys were mentioning, like, during the entire, like, panel session about, like, how you should just focus on the audience members that, like, are willing to support you and everything like that. But being, like, in a medium like film that, like, is really powerful in, like, changing opinions and stuff like that, how do you go about changing those fixed mindsets? Like, those people that are just so stubborn that they won't see and, like, they won't, like, change their mind about things? Because, like, feel like if you get their support, like, that just changes things completely.
How does it change things?
Because there's less people judging against you guys. And then after, it makes it, like, easier towards getting to, like, a path where, like, everybody's accepting of one another.
But does it not take a person to actually choose not to judge somebody?
Yes. Okay. I just, like, I want to know, like...
I make this work. I know what you're saying.
It's just, like, I'm just, like, angry because some people just don't see that.
And this is and this is what happens. Because I'm a little older than you, or much older than you. I used to feel exactly like that. And this is the thing that connects to what you're saying. As you get a little bit older, you seek different places to find that support so you can actually minimize the anger. The anger is going to drive you insane. And the best thing to do with that is to channel that anger into the focus of the core of what you need to say, which is your work. It's not going to stop the song you're going to write or the painting you're going to make. If you're constantly thinking about how am I going to change folks, you're going to leave yourself out of it. Right? Because all this stuff is you. All you have is you to get up in the morning to write a script or to go out and put a crew together or spend time with somebody to actually try to tell their story or get at something. There's so much to go on in there that there's enough to do, is what I'm saying. So that anger can fuel you, and as you get older, you're going to find how that anger is going to channel into something else that's probably going to be more enlightening in another way. But I think it's a wave you have to go through. I think you have to go through a state of anger. I think then you have to find the next space, right? And I think that's part of the journey that you're going to be on.
People are not always persuaded, I think, in the way that we imagine that they are persuaded, which often has to do with us spending a lot of time and energy convincing them. You know what also really persuades people, and they hate to admit it, is action. And this is why Black Lives Matter Toronto is the most discussed activist group that I have ever seen since I've been covering the news in Toronto. Because they don't wait until everybody's like, oh, I agree with you now. They just go do it. And people, let me see if I can break this down a little bit. I feel like what it is that people are actually angry at BLMTO because they're like, you haven't consulted with us yet. You're out here like there's no debate to be had. And they're like, that's correct. There is no debate. There is no debate. What you're doing is wrong. And we are not actually going to debate with you because the longer that we sit here and pretend, like, for example, shooting an unarmed black person is debatable, the longer that we do that, the less time we have to spend on actually fixing the problem. I don't think it's responsible to spend our energy on people who don't want to listen to us. But I tell you something, when you lead by example, that really actually does influence people because it shows them I care about this so much that I am actually not. And by the way, guys, this is not a bad thing because we do this all the time in society to show the things that we care about. So when we find out that somebody is hurting a child, we don't sit around and have a debate about whether or not it was good to hurt a child. We just try to stop it from happening. Are there people who maybe think that there are circumstances that it's okay to hurt a child? Yes, there are. Would you like me to give you an example? There was a story in the news a couple of weeks ago of a 6-year-old girl who was shackled in her own classroom in Mississauga, who was handcuffed by her wrists and her ankles. She weighs 47 pounds, and the school decided that because she was having an episode in her classroom, that the teachers were not going to choose to deal with her, that they were going to call the police. This girl weighs 47 pounds. She is also black. So I'm in the news media, and I can tell you that a lot of people spent a lot of time debating whether or not it was a good thing to handcuff a 6-year-old, 47-pound girl by her wrists and ankles. I refuse to debate people who want to say that that could ever be right. I'm looking right past them to get justice for that girl and for her family. I don't have time. And by showing people I refuse to debate with you, I am moving the issue forward by saying this is so urgent and so important that we don't have time for the people who are not with us. Does that make sense? That can also be very persuasive, and I think is sometimes more important than fighting with people.
What were some of the major setbacks you guys encountered while creating this project?
Major setbacks?
Yeah.
We don't have any of those. I think the major, I wouldn't even say it's setbacks, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like challenges that come up, and I think it was, for me, in this particular project, it was again, it's like making film, making stuff, didn't start as something that wasn't personal for me. It never was not that. My entry point of the first short film I made and whatever. Sure, you do other things, but it's like, that was probably the biggest challenge. I wouldn't say it was a setback. It's also a driving thing. It drives you. The things that, you know, scare you too. So the emotional engagement, because for me, when you go out and you make this stuff, you build so many connections. You build so many relationships. And the problem is like, well, you know, I don't like to go in and take something and then leave or whatever, or this or that. But these are real people. And it's hard to maintain some of these relationships because you really care about the scenarios. But then you're making a piece that you're going to present, and then in a way, you move on to another project. But it's affected your life. And so it's hard to find, you know, comfortable spaces because you're so connected to these people.
I had two big challenges with doing this, and they were related. So one was that I really often did not want to see these guys. Like, when they would come to my house with a friggin' film crew at 9 in the morning on a Saturday when I've been working all week. Like, I don't actually want to see him. I don't want to talk to him. I don't want to put his microphone on. You know, we'll go out and we're on the road and I haven't slept and I'm in a hotel room, a big, big empty bed by myself, and this man's knocking on my door to get up so we have to go somewhere. I don't really like Charles that much, you know? Like, I didn't want to see him those days. I mean, I love Charles. I just didn't like him on those days. It's a huge intrusion into people's lives who are not getting paid and are not paid to work on this documentary when we just roll up on them and put a camera in their face, put a microphone in their face, ask them to tell us their most personal stories when we have never met them before. We literally landed in Ferguson on a Friday afternoon and went to a protest of a guy who was beat by the police and was like, hey, never met you before. Tell me all about the most traumatic experience you've ever had. That's like, I personally have a hard time even asking people that I don't know to do this for us. Mm-hmm. That was hard. But you have to, because you're recognizing that by sharing that story, something greater is going to come out of it. And hopefully it can provide validation and healing for that person, that somebody wants to listen, that somebody came all the way from far away to hear their story and to be like, I'm very sorry that that happened to you.
But my question, I guess, is do you think it's okay to let your work, like, resonate with you emotionally? Like, I know sometimes it gets, like, obviously, as you can see while watching the clips, like, do you think that's an okay feeling to have? I think it's okay, but I've had people not think it's okay to get emotionally attached to your work like that.
I think you have to have some sort of perspective. But if you're a living, breathing human being and you watch something and it is actually, you've captured it, there's separation. All you were there was to be the vessel to capture it. Now you're participating as an audience member. Again, if you can find that too. And if you do something, I think the test as a filmmaker for me is that if I can watch something and have that, because it's not like, oh, I love my work so much. I'm so like, you know. But you can watch with that separation, then still actually get emotional about it. It means you captured something that is independent of you. You know what I mean? So I think you should be looking for that as you, and building your gauge of how you can feel emotionally engaged. Because if you're a participant, if you feel emotionally engaged, then maybe someone sitting beside you will too, right? So you have to be. Yeah, I think you have to be. I think what people are talking about is like, oh, I love my shot. Like Spike Lee, if you ever listen to any of his like his commentaries on his DVDs, he never talks about the scenes. He's like, yo, look at this shot. Oh my God! Like I did it. Oh man, this one's coming up. It's so entertaining. Just put on his DVD like commentary and watch a film, and it's hilarious. But it's like, that's different, you know. But I think you should be emotionally engaged because you want other people to be emotionally engaged somewhere.
Also, nobody ever says that about, like, for example, people who make comedy, right? Yeah. If you enjoy the fact that people laugh at your work, like, that's the whole reason why you're doing it. So nobody ever says, don't get so emotionally involved in your comedy routine, you know? You want people to laugh. That's the whole point.
I think the funniest comedians are the ones that like laugh at their jokes.
Yo,
makes you laugh.
It does.
Like, it just totally keeps you going.
It's real because that's real. And so like I, as I said earlier, I don't think we need that really hard line of separation. What I actually think is going on there is that a lot of the time this is being said about a certain kind of work being done by a certain group of people, and what's being said is that, again, as I mentioned, it's not professional, right? That there's something unprofessional about having that emotional response and connection to your own work. What I actually think is really being said there is that it's dangerous to have too much sympathy for your subjects. It's dangerous to have too much sympathy for when you're doing the work about people who are being treated badly. That, like, somehow journalism or filmmaking requires you to have a healthy distance from that. And I'm just like, no, I want to go and sit and cry with the people who are having a tough time. Because that relates to my life. If you don't want to do that, if you always want to make movies about the white guy who saves everybody and wins everything, that, as if that, by the way, doesn't have emotional connotations as well, then you go and do that. If that resonates with you, like, go do that. This is what resonates with me. You know what I mean? And it obviously, it goes beyond us. We know who our audience is, as Charles mentioned before. We know that there are people that this just makes sense to because they're seeing it and going, I know what that like. It's like, my family knows what that's like. I've been living that. That's who we're trying to reach.
You guys talked a lot about like not separating your work and your personal life because it's something that's a part of you. You also talk about allyship a lot and how it's important to educate yourself. But I know personally for me, like, it's impossible for me to separate being Black and from everything in my life. But I, like, you know, to quote Solange Knowles in her song Mad, you know, like, people ask, why are you so mad all the time? Or, like, why can't you just explain to me? I don't get it. Like, how can you just talk about, like, just being tired of doing that, even though you choose to do, like, that's your job. Like, that's what you would love to do. But for me, and I'm sure for you, and I know every other Black person, they get tired. And just if you want to talk about that a little bit.
Tired right now.
Ditto.
Straight up. Like, listen, I know these folk, it's like, it's a tiring journey. Like, it's an amazing opportunity that we're here, we're able to have this conversation and stuff, but when we leave here, we're back in it, right? And you're back in that space, and it's tiring to be a human being. It's tiring to be to live in a certain culture and space right now. It's gotta be so tiring to, you know, to be Muslim, there's so many things, right? And I think you have to, and I don't think some of us, like, yeah, it's true, like, don't sleep a lot, kind of constantly doing things and whatever. But in the film, when you watch it on the 9th, at 9 p.m. on CBC, Desmond quotes somebody, Audre Lorde, right? And it's it is a revolutionary act to love ourselves as Black people.
Yep.
It's revolutionary. Yep. And that stems into people taking to the streets or finding other ways or painting or doing things. It's still coming from loving yourself. So it's all love work. And you seek your community and your friends and so on and so forth to help you, to give you strength and support. That's what you gotta find, the people that are gonna help you to support you, you know, because it's tiring.
And that relates back to what I was saying earlier, which is that why would we spend all of our time when this is already so hard? Why would we spend the time that we have outside of the work fighting with people who don't love us? Right? We have to build each other up. We have to take care of one another. That's a responsibility that we all have. And so we have to find ways to heal ourselves and to keep going, even though the work is incredibly challenging and difficult. And that's why I say we focus on ourselves rather than putting all the energy always out there, because this work can completely wear you out. I know that sometimes people describe the phenomenon of burning out as being like that's the rock bottom. Like, you hit the rock bottom and you burn out, and then, like, I don't know, like, you can't work again or something like that. I'm in constant burnout. I'm in constant line, that line of feeling like, man, I don't know if I could do this anymore. I don't know if I can wake up and do this anymore. But at the same time, my uncle told us stories, my mom's brother, about moving to Canada from Sierra Leone. He worked the night shift at 7-Eleven. That was his first job. People used to make fun of my black uncle for coming all the way from Africa to sell people cigarettes at 3 in the morning. Like, that must suck for you. Ha, 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 ha. That was hard, too. That was difficult, too. But because my family was willing to do stuff like that, I could sit on this stage and talk to you. So I also honor the fact that it's never been easy for us. That has always been a struggle. And that I'm benefiting from the fact that people worked so hard and sacrificed so hard before me to give me this. Because I didn't just make this all on my own. My parents know what it feels like to be tired. Trust me. My grandmother, who came here in her 60s and wasn't going to get a pension of any kind unless she worked first, was an old woman. She knows what it means to be tired. So I'm just reaping the benefits of all the hard work that she did and trying to do something so that it's a little easier for somebody coming after me.
So that's our panel. Thank you all so much for joining
us
today.
All.
It was a
thank
huge
you,
pleasure.
Thank you.
And again, March 9th, 9 p.m., CBC.
CBC.
Tune in to watch the full film.
March 9th.
And there'll be more things, and there are things on the CBC site that might be helpful and useful to learn a little bit more, if you like, and watch this woman on CBC.
She's always.
All the time.
This woman, please. Amazing things.
Thank you, Amanda.
Thank you, Amanda.